Hello, everybody. Jonathan Flom here, also known as JFLO, and welcome to the next installment in our continuing lecture series, At Home with Professor JFLO. Today, as we start to wrap up the semester, I am going to begin covering a very broad topic, but one that is near and dear to my heart, which is musical theater. Musical theater is something I've been doing since I was in probably 7th or 8th grade, and I've got a couple of degrees in it. I've written a couple of books. I've taught and directed professionally all over the world, and so I feel like I'm in a pretty decent position to share with you a few thoughts about the art form. And I want to start by saying that musical theater is one of the very few uniquely American art forms. It started here, it was given its incubation period here, and even today, the majority of the world's most powerful and innovative musicals are American. And as someone who has taught and directed internationally, I can say that the whole world actually looks to us for taking the lead in the world of musical theater. So it's something we can be proud of and lay claim to. Now, as you're watching this, maybe you've seen some musicals before. In fact, I would hope that you've seen at least one, because if you're taking the Art of the Theater courses at Slippery Rock, that means you were required to see the 25th Annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. So I know you've seen at least one musical, but maybe you've seen others in your life. Maybe you grew up in a house where your family listened to musical cast recordings or watched The Sound of Music sitting around the dinner table together, or as you do, or sitting around the living room or the fire. I don't know what you do in your homes, and it's none of my business. But here's the thing. This is the point I'm trying to make. Some people really love musicals, and some people really don't. And I want you to know, before we dive into this, that I understand. I really do. If you don't like musical theater, I don't fault you for that. I'm not going to try and change your mind. I mean, I understand the argument against musical theater, right? These characters that are sort of living their lives all of a sudden break into song. And it's just so artificial, right? Because in real life, people don't just break into song. That's so fake. And it would never happen in real life. And you probably don't like musicals because you like things that are grounded in reality, things that are grounded in a sort of naturalism. You want to see life as it is. And so, believe me, I understand that people don't just break into song and dance to expound on their feelings. And if you prefer something really believable, I get it. I really do. But just for this little time that we have together, just go with me. Because as it turns out, there are some people that do really appear to like musical theater. Now, I will admit, let's be honest, some of it is absolute crap.
I have a Gumby cat in mind. Her name is Jenny Any Dots.
But when it's good, it can be remarkable.
All this running and shouting. What is it now, dear?
I had him and then...
Oh, the sailor burst in. I saw them both running down the street and I said to myself, well, fat...
I had him. His throat was bare beneath my hand.
There, dear, don't fret.
No, I had him. His throat was there. Now he'll never come again.
Now. Hush, love, hush. I keep telling you.
When?
What's your rush?
Why do I wait? You told me to wait. Now he'll never come again.
But I'm here now to give you a crash course in how we went from this
When the curtain would rise on the Ziegfeld Follies, first and foremost, you'd see spectacular settings, the like of which you'd never seen before, shimmering with color and light. Then we bring out the ladies of the ensemble.
To this.
I'm past patiently waiting, I'm passionately smashing every expectation, every action's an act of creation. I'm laughing in the face of casualties of sorrow. The first time I'm thinking past tomorrow.
When I am not going to wait my shot,
where did this American phenomenon come from? How did it begin? Why didn't we learn in high school that Hamilton could rap? These are the questions we're going to really get out. Now, this information that I'm about to dive in and share with you is part of a broad course that I teach, which is called Musical Theater History, in which I desperately try to cram way too much information in one semester. So it only makes sense that now I'll try to cram it all into one or two short video lessons, and I'm sure we won't leave anything out at all. So anyhow, here goes. Thank you so much. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Sit, have a seat. Thank you so much. Welcome to At Home with Professor J. Flo. I'm your host, Jonathan Flom. So nice to be here with you once again as we begin week 47 of the Corona lockdown. Look, I don't know about you, but I'm starting to go a little stir crazy. But I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Yes, the semester is almost over, and I, for one, I'm really looking forward to the summer. I mean, we'll finally be able to sleep late, sit around the house all day in our underwear, sit on the couch watching Netflix. I mean, it's gonna be a real great change coming. But anyway, no time for daydreaming. We have so much to get to today because we are covering the American musical theater. And that is a very broad topic, so let's dive right in, shall we? Now, in order to really understand musical theater, you need to know where it comes from. So let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start.
Let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start.
Look, that is not the first bad musical theater joke I've made, and it won't be the last. So if you're not down with my rockin' dad jokes, it's gonna be a long 17 hours for you. Anyway, moving on. As I said in the cold open, musical theater is an American art form. Even today, it is performed all around the world, but the vast majority of musicals are actually American shows. But how did this phenomenon begin? Well, to answer that, we have to look back at four types of earlier entertainment that paved the way for musicals. The first is operetta, also known as comic opera or light opera. Operetta was like opera for the middle class. While the singing was beautiful, the stories were less heavy and tragic than opera. And while opera was meant to be taken very seriously, operetta had a much better sense of humor. Like opera, operetta included beautiful singing, a style called bel canto, which is Italian for beautiful singing. And operetta also often included dance. But the beautiful singers were never expected to dance. No, for that, an entire dancing chorus was brought in. So every opera company basically had two entire sets of unique performers. You had the singing actors, and then you had the dancing chorus. And in addition to beautiful singing, or bel canto style of singing, operetta also gave rise to a very important song form that would be used very liberally by the American musical later on, and that is called a patter song. A patter song is a verbal tour de force where the singer tries to fit as many words as possible into a short musical phrase. I'm going to give you an example of a patter song, and this is from the 1879 operetta, The Pirates of Penzance, which was written by British composer and lyricist Gilbert and Sullivan. This song is entitled, I Am the Very Model of a Modern Major General. It's a great example of a patter song. Take a look.
I am the very model of a modern major general. Life, information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England, and I quote the Pikes historical from Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I'm very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorem, I'm teeming with a lot of news. Ooh, lot of news, lot of news. Got it. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
So the patter song gets used all throughout musical theater, and it developed from operetta. And you know, as a side note, I would argue that you might even say that operetta was an early forerunner to rap music. I am the very model of a modern major general. I've information vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England, and I quote the fights historical from Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I mean, I don't want to say that I'm the next Lin-Manuel Miranda, but oh wait, we haven't gotten to Lin-Manuel Miranda. Let's stay focused, Flom. There is so much more I could say about operetta, but we don't have the time. So let's move on to the second art form that influenced the development of musicals, and that art form was called vaudeville. Now, vaudeville was the term used for the variety shows in the early part of the 20th century, which were likely the most popular entertainment in the country. A typical vaudeville performance would include between 10 to 15 individual acts, ranging from singers, dancers, stand-up comics, ventriloquists, acrobats, and some of the oddest assortment of special skills you've ever seen. Vaudeville were family-friendly performances, and there were vaudeville houses all over the country. We would consider these vaudeville shows to be very presentational in their form, meaning that they always acknowledged the audience and engaged with them directly, as opposed to a representational performance, which was meant to be performed as though the audience wasn't there. The actors would perform behind that imaginary fourth wall and try and create something that was more realistic. Vaudeville was never an attempt to be realistic. It was never an attempt to tell a unified story. It was simply a form of entertainment, and it was very popular. Now, the third of the four origin art forms springs from vaudeville, but it's sort of the dark underside of vaudeville, and it was called burlesque. You've probably heard of burlesque, thanks Christina Aguilera and Cher, but maybe you didn't actually know what it meant before now. Now, original burlesque was actually imported from England, and it was styled like vaudeville, but the important difference was that it really focused on women. And the women in burlesque tended to show a fair amount of skin, which was pretty risque for the time. Now, some look back on burlesque and consider it a form of feminism or a form of empowerment for women, but really, in the time period, it was just a new and risque way of bringing people into the theater, presenting a vaudeville-style variety entertainment. And in fact, the shows in burlesque were often parodies of vaudeville shows. And eventually, as burlesque continued to become popular in the sort of seedy underbelly of the entertainment world, it also expanded into what became known as the striptease. And of course, that's now what we think of when we hear the term burlesque. We often think of it as strippers, but that's not how it originated. Finally, the fourth of the original art forms that gave rise to the musical was called the minstrel show. And I have to warn you, the minstrel show is a dark and terrible piece of American history. Minstrel shows were performances where white artists dressed in blackface and performed what they considered parodies of African Americans.
I'm an eagle, I'm a mason, I'm a elk, I'm a knight. I'm Reggie Bud Wright, you hear me talking? I'm Reggie Bud Wright.
Minstrel shows appropriated black culture and some black spiritual music, and it did it through the guise of comedy sketches and songs and variety entertainment. And lest you think that minstrel shows were just performed and created by horrible racist people who have since been wiped off the face of the earth, I have to tell you that some of the most popular composers and performers of the time were involved in minstrel shows. In the time, they didn't think it was bad. They didn't think they were doing something wrong. Artists like Irving Berlin, who you might or might not know his name, but you certainly know some of his songs. He wrote White Christmas, and he wrote God Bless America. Well, before he wrote White Christmas and God Bless America, Irving Berlin was composing music for minstrel shows. And eventually, black people themselves began to actually perform in minstrel shows, wearing blackface, exaggerated or exaggerated white lips, and they basically said, if you can't beat them, join them. Now, minstrel shows, as I said, were a dark and terrible time in American cultural history, but they did contribute to the development of the American musical theater. Without minstrel shows, we might not have had the style of music called ragtime, which was made very popular in minstrel shows. And we also might not have tap dance in our musicals, because that comes from minstrel shows as well. So, just to recap, before musical theater, we had operetta, vaudeville, burlesque, and minstrel shows. Now, before I dive headlong into the American musical, I want to make sure you know some basic terminology, because we're going to use these terms frequently. So, check these, write these down. The first term I want you to know is score. The score is essentially the term for the music in a musical, and that score is written by the person who is called the composer. So the composer writes the music, and we call the music the score. Next, I'm sure you know the term lyrics. Lyrics are the words to the songs, and those are written by the lyricist. So already we have a collaboration between the composer and the lyricist. The next term I want you to know is book. Book is also often called the libretto. Those two are interchangeable terms, and essentially they mean the script of a musical. So if the songs are the score and the lyrics are the lyrics, then the spoken dialogue and the framework for the musical is called the book or the libretto. And that is written by a person who is called the librettist or the book writer. Usually we just refer to them as the librettist. And finally, another term that I'm sure you're familiar with, choreography. When I say choreography, I'm talking about the dance that is in a musical, and of course that choreography is created by the choreographer. And one thing I want to make sure that you understand is that musical theater is probably the highest collaborative art form that exists. Just to write a musical, you might have a separate composer, lyricist, book writer, director, music director who does the conducting of the orchestra, and choreographer. And that's just the main creative team. Don't even get me started on all of the designers and the sound people and the actors and so on and so forth. It is a high, high, high collaborative form. But those are some terms that I just want to make sure you know before we dive in. Now, look, there are so many musicals that I'd like to teach you about. But as I'm learning currently in my musical theater history seminar, there's just not enough time. Suffice it to say that there's a long, deep, and rich history behind the American musical, and I think you'd find it fascinating. But in our very limited time, I'm going to just hit some of the highlights. Are you ready? Here we go.
Give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square. Tell all the gang at 42nd Street that I will soon be there.
Let's begin in the early 1900s. The American musical, originally referred to as musical comedy, rises out of the vaudeville tradition with people like George M. Cohan. George M. Cohan was a Broadway impresario, a producer, a director, a writer, a choreographer, a singer, dancer, who grew up in the vaudeville, literally grew up in vaudeville theaters. His family was a touring vaudeville troupe of performers, and they say that George M. Cohan took his first bow at 2 years old and never looked back. George M. Cohan takes the vaudeville tradition and turns it into what we now think of as musical comedies, and he's famous for writing songs such as You're a Grand Old Flag, Yankee Doodle Dandy, and Give My Regards to Broadway. And we also have people like producer Florenz Ziegfeld, who imported a European style called the Follies, which highlighted the beauty of the American girl in high-budget grand productions. George M. Cohan's Everyman kind of musicals and Florenz Ziegfeld's beautiful, elaborate, stunning spectacle productions were the early days of musical comedy. And the first 25 years of the musical comedy, the plots were very thin, the songs were the popular hits of the day, and the shows were just meant to be light and entertaining. But then we hit 1927, where the musical makes an overnight leap from infancy to teenager. Showboat.
This is how to get 'em.
Hey, where do you think you're going? Don't you know this show is gone soon? Hey, just a few things left here. It's light and fine, now fly there no more.
Oh, listen, sister, I love my Mr. Man. And I can't tell you why.
When Showboat came out, they created a whole new name for the art form. It could no longer be called musical comedy because this was serious material. They referred to Showboat as a musical play. Based on a sweeping epic novel by Edna Ferber about life in the American South post-Civil War to the 1920s, Showboat had a score by composer Jerome Kern. Go ahead and look him up on Spotify if you've never heard of him, but I'll bet you've heard a lot of his songs and in various jazz covers. He was a very popular composer of the time. And it had a book and lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein II. You may have heard the name Hammerstein, as in Rodgers and we'll get to that soon enough. But Showboat was important because it was the first musical to deal with serious themes, which included alcoholism, gambling, divorce, and even miscegenation, which is the illegal marriage between a white and a black person. Showboat was also important because it was the first professional theater show to have both black and white cast performers on stage together, in scenes together. Showboat not only told a story about integration, but it literally had integration involved in its production. But perhaps Showboat was most important to this particular lecture because it did something new. For the first time, all of the songs, all of the music in Showboat was specifically and directly connected to the story. Kern and Hammerstein pushed the American musical forward beyond mere entertainment and proved that an audience would consider musicals that had real meat on them. Now, Showboat was an absolute triumph and a major game changer, and it brought us hit songs such as Old Man River, in which a secondary character named Joe reflects on life from the point of view of the Mississippi River.
Old Man River, that old man river, he must know something, but don't say nothing, he just keeps rolling, he keeps on.
What Oscar Hammerstein did, I think, primarily was to marry European operetta and American musical comedy tradition. And Showboat is the apotheosis of that, in which you tell a story, but unlike European operetta, a serious story, or a story that has some realism, if you want to use such a word. And I think that one of the reasons Showboat turned out as well as it did is that Kern knew what Oscar was trying to do. And he was just as interested in doing it.
I'm tired of living and scared of dying, but Old Man River, he just keeps rolling along.
Showboat changed the game for sure, but it took a little time for that to noticeably happen. You see, as it turns out, Showboat happened right on the heels of the Great Depression. And just as suddenly as Showboat demonstrated that a musical comedy could handle serious fare, America was plunged into a dark and difficult time in which no one was looking to go to the theater to be depressed. They needed escapism, they needed great melodies again, and light storylines, and what they got for the next 15 years was the musical comedy works of people like Rodgers and Hart.
You don't know that I felt good when we up and parted.
You don't know I knocked on wood, gladly brokenhearted.
Worrying through, I sleep all night. Apathy. appetite and health restored. You don't know how much we're bored.
The sleepless nights, the daily fights, the quick toboggan when you reach the heights. I miss the kisses and I miss the bites. I wish I were in love again.
The broken dates, the endless waits, the lovely loving and the hateful hates. The conversation with the flying plates. I wish I were in love again.
No more pain.
No more strain.
Now I'm sane, but I would rather be gone, gone.
Cole Porter, an elite, wealthy, educated, highly, highly sophisticated man who wrote stories that reflected his sophistication in musicals like Anything Goes and Paris.
No kick from champagne. Mere alcohol doesn't thrill me at all. So tell me, why should it be true that I get a kick out of you? Some go for perfume from Spain. That if I took even one sniff, it would bore me terrifically too. Yet I get a kick out of you.
And George and Ira Gershwin, a team of two brothers, George, who was the composer, Ira, who was the lyricist, who wrote some of the most popular songs of American history.
Do I get that way? Look at what I've gone. I got rhythm, I got music, I got my man. Who could ask for anything more? I got daisies in green pastures. I got my man. Who could ask for anything more? Oh man, trouble, I don't mind him. You won't find him round my door. I got starlight, I got sweet dreams. I got my man. Who could ask for anything more? Who could ask for anything more?
Again, I would love to have the time to really dive into the great musicals of the 1930s with you, but in the interest of time, we're going to have to jump from Showboat to the next major landmark in the history of the American musical. In 1943, composer Richard Rodgers of Rodgers and Hart and lyricist Oscar Hammerstein II of Showboat, you know, 2 minutes ago, you remember Oscar Hammerstein, right? You still with me? Okay, great. Rodgers and Hammerstein get together and they begin the greatest and most important and enduring collaboration in all of musical theater when, in 1943, they adapted a novel by Lynn Riggs about farmers and cowboys trying to stake their claim to a new burgeoning American territory, and specifically about one particular farmhand and one cowboy's competition for the love of a young beauty named Lori. Oklahoma changed the musical theater landscape instantly. The integrated show elements that Kern and Hammerstein created in Showboat, where the songs were connected directly to the story rather than just being entertainment, was taken to a whole new level. In Oklahoma, all of the songs are vital to the storytelling. The characters use song to express their inner desires in what came later to be known as the I Want song.
Watch that fringe and see how it flutters when I drive them high-stepping strutters. Nosy pokes all peek through their shutters and their eyes will pop. The wheels are yellow, the upholstery's brown, the dashboard's genuine leather. With isinglass curtains you can roll right down in case there's a change in the weather.
Almost every musical in the years that followed have an I Want song or multiple I Want songs. And they also innovated in the way that what might have once been considered dialogue is now turned into musical scenes, and suddenly the songs have the function of pushing the plot further along.
What'd you say, the fringe was made of silk?
Oh,
wouldn't have no other kind but silk.
Has it really got a team of snow white horses?
One's like snow, the other's more like milk.
So you can tell them apart.
And perhaps the biggest innovation, Oklahoma brings ballet choreographer Agnes DeMille into the world of the musical, and suddenly we have a show where dance is used to further the story. So much so that at the end of Act One, while young Laurie struggles to decide which man to choose, she falls into a fever dream in which she sees the hardened farmer Judd Fry abduct and kill her true love, Curly. Famously known as the Dream Ballet, this demonstrated that dance could carry the plot just as easily as dialogue or music. So, Oklahoma changes the game in 1943. And let's not let it go unnoticed that Oscar Hammerstein's name was involved in both of those landmark musical shifts. And he's going to give rise to some more great change indirectly a little bit later on, so stay tuned for that. But after Oklahoma, what happened is remarkable. All of a sudden, the musical has a new form. Most other composers and writers looked at Oklahoma and said, now that's how you write a fucking musical. And we get the beginning of what comes to be known as the Golden Age of musical theater. Now, the Golden Age is a time where musical theater was the most popular art form in America, more popular than films, more popular than television. And the musical is being written along the same structure as Oklahoma, using songs and dance to further the plot, becoming more and more sophisticated, while also at the same time turning out hit popular songs. Oh yes, did you know that in the 1940s and well into the 50s, musical theater songs were the popular music of the day? Well, they were. Rodgers and Hammerstein had stumbled onto a formula that shaped a generation of American entertainment. They followed Oklahoma with a slew of other hit musicals, including Carousel, South Pacific, The King and I, and The Sound of Music, just to name a few, all of which took on very challenging subject matter, from spousal abuse to racism. Their musical work also paved the way for other popular and enduring musicals, such as Guys and Dolls.
I dreamed last night I got on the boat to heaven, and by some chance I had brought my dice along. And there I stood, and I hollered, someone fade me. But the passengers, they knew right from wrong. For the people all said, sit down, you're rocking the boat. People all said, sit down, you're rocking the boat. And the devil will drag you under by the sharp lapel of your checkered coat. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, you're rocking the boat. I sailed away on that little boat to heaven, and by some chance found a bottle in my fist. And there I stood nicely passing out the whiskey, but the passengers were bound to resist. For the people all said, beware, you're on a heavenly trip. People all said, beware, beware, you'll scuttle the ship. And the devil will drag you under by the fancy tie round your wicked throat. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, you're rocking the boat.
My Fair Lady.
Where's that soggy plane?
In Spain, in Spain.
No plane, Spain, 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 in the plane. The rain, he's raining, the rain, the rain.
You've all been working much too hard. I think the strain is beginning to show. Eliza, I don't care what Mr. Higgins says. You must put down your books and go to sleep.
Sleep, sleep. I couldn't sleep tonight. Not for all the jewels in my crown. I could have danced all night. I could have danced all night. And still have begged for more. I could have spread my wings and done a thousand things I've never done before.
West Side Story.
Mama!
Fiddler on the Roof.
A fiddler on the roof. Sounds crazy, no? But in our little village of Anatevka, you might say every one of us is a fiddler on the roof, trying to scratch out a pleasant, simple tune without breaking his neck. It isn't easy. You may ask, why do we stay up there if it's so dangerous? We stay because Anatevka is our home. And how do we keep our balance? That I can tell you in one word. Tradition!
Tradition, tradition. Tradition, tradition, tradition. Tradition.
Because of our traditions, we've kept our balance for many, many years. Here in Anatevka, we have traditions for everything. How to eat, how to sleep, how to work, how to wear clothes. For instance, we always keep our heads covered and always wear a little prayer shawl. This shows our constant devotion to God. You may ask, how did this tradition start? I'll tell you. I don't know, but it's a tradition. Because of our traditions, everyone knows who he is and what God expects him to do.
Who day and night must scramble for a living, feed a wife and children, say his daily prayers, and who has the right, as master of the house, to have the final word at home? The Papa! The Papa! Tradition! The Papa!
Again, I could go on and on for weeks just to take you through all the brilliant shows that came out of the golden age of the American musical theater, but we don't have time for that. And frankly, you might not care that much. You might be sitting there waiting with anticipation for this lecture to end so you can go back to watching Tiger King. And believe me, I understand that. So I'm not going to profile the other musicals of the golden age. Instead, I'm going to tell you that later, in the latter half of the Golden Age, musical theater and popular music experienced a pretty big rift. When rock and roll came along, and Elvis Presley appeared on your parents' televisions on a program called The Ed Sullivan Show, people were hypnotized by a man's pelvis, and suddenly, rock was the popular form of music. Musical theater songs became a niche genre, enjoyed by a certain type of person. The type of person who would go to a musical, I guess. But as the 50s progressed and moved on into the 60s, show tunes received less and less radio airplay, fewer and fewer popular covers on the radio, and it was sort of pushed aside by the explosion of rock music from Elvis to the Beatles. And the Broadway musical really became seen as its own genre of music. While rock and roll and rhythm and blues were the mainstream, Broadway musicals used to turn out the popular hits of the day, and that wasn't really happening anymore, other than the occasional cover song here and there during the late 1950s and the early 60s. Until